Have you been using unwaxed dental floss, Judy?
Sure, yeah.
But not every night.
No.
And the water pick?
I sometimes I don't go on foot. I don't always do it.
Water pick taking up room on the shelf? Well, that's all till next time. Now, I want to see you in 6 weeks. But meantime, if you have any pain of any kind, I'll always make time for you.
Promise I'll floss constantly, Dr. Fleckstein.
Bruce!
Thank you. is a beautiful place, your Thornfield. Goodbye, Mr. Rochester.
Goodbye, Miss Eyre. Jane, that all seems stinted in my notion. Dry and unfriendly. Want to do more than just say goodbye?
Well, I'll shake hands, sir.
Will you shake hands?
This just in on a news update. In the Long Island community of Shorehaven, the body of dentist Bruce Fleckstein was discovered this afternoon, murdered in his office. Police say they have no leads, but an intensive investigation has begun. Further details on our 7:30 broadcast.
Okay, Jolly, get your coats on, quick. Quick, we're gonna go to Mrs. Miller's house.
All right, what do you think? Yeah.
It's good.
Yeah, silly. All right, all right. Did you wipe your feet?
No.
Hi, Ball, Logan.
Hi.
Where's your mom?
Hi.
Well, you can see it here, okay? Right, can you watch He-Man for 10 minutes?
Sure.
Okay,
sure.
All right, happy. Okay. Nancy! Nan!
In the studio, Toots.
Nan? Isn't it incredible? I can't believe it. Did you hear?
Obviously not. What?
Bruce Fleckstein was murdered. The dentist, the one I just went to see?
Mr. Slick with all the gold chains?
Dr. Slick. A homicide. I just saw it on television.
Well, do they have any idea who did it?
Well, they didn't say. I don't know. Maybe it was an addict looking for drugs or someone whose gums were still bleeding after $50,000.
That's too boring. It's probably somebody he was humping. I heard that gum surgery took second place for old Brucey.
Well, he did seem a little overly friendly, but I never thought for a second that he actually, you know, meant it.
Judith, do you think that every man who talks to you wants to establish a dialogue? I mean, what do you expect him to do, hang it out his trousers and wave it at you?
Oh, that'd be a fair indication.
But why would one of his women want to kill him?
Maybe he wouldn't go down on her.
Don't you think murder is just a little bit excessive?
I most certainly do not.
A dentist. God, I'd love to kill a dentist.
Well, it wasn't just a dentist. It was a periodontist. He's a hotshot gum specialist. Sit down, don't you? You're going to mess something up. Anyway, you know what Nancy said? Bob.
What?
Nancy said that he was having tons of affairs. Really, this guy was the Don Juan of dentists, and it happened here in Shorehaven. I mean, there must have been a dozen people who wanted to see the guy dead, his ex-mistresses and jealous husbands. I can't believe somebody I opened my mouth to has been murdered.
I fail to see why you find this all so enthralling.
Hey, Joey, look at that.
I don't know. I mean, everything in Shorehaven has always been so... so clean and so perfect, so, you know, nice. I mean, everybody's got a nice clothes, nice car, nice kids, nice house. And underneath all of that, this was going on. Something else, something passionate and messy. I mean, somebody stepped over the line, Bob. Somebody killed somebody.
So? Fleckstein?
Yeah, Fleckstein.
One of my partners was talking about Fleckstein. What's the other two? Oh.
Well, think of who it was, darling.
This is my favorite suit.
I know, we'll get him cleaned up. Don't laugh at your father. Coming!
Sergeant Williams, Nassau County Police. You've heard about the Fleckstein murder?
Oh, yeah, I saw it on TV last night.
Did you happen to notice what time your neighbor... Mrs. Tuccio came home last night.
Peg Tuccio. Why?
She was his last appointment yesterday. The last person to see him alive.
I saw Fleckstein last week. If I'd been his last patient, would that automatically make me a suspect?
Do you have any reason to believe he was keeping company with other women?
Well, he was a ladies' man.
Did he ever make any advances toward you?
Yeah. Well, I mean, he didn't jump on my body and throw me on the floor or anything, but I knew, I mean, there was a, you know, I felt uncomfortable. Actually, I was thinking of trying to find a way out of my next appointment. But I never would have gone that far. I mean, that's kind of excessive, isn't it?
Judith, you won't believe it.
This homicide lieutenant was here for 2 hours last night.
2 hours? Peg, what did he ask you?
Did Dr. Fleckstein seem upset about anything? Did he get any phone calls? Oh, gosh, what else? What time did his nurse go home?
Did he seem anxious to get rid of me?
What'd you tell him?
Well, you understand that practically the whole time I had that laughing gas thing on my face, so I was really floating. Gee, I wonder if that's what marijuana feels like.
Did he get any phone calls?
I don't think so. You think those are too sweet? The recipe calls for really tart apples.
Perfect. Was there anybody else around? Any other patients?
Nope. Actually, I wish there had been. I didn't like being alone with him after his nurse went home. That's why when I finally left, I was glad to see a couple of other people in the hall.
Who?
I forget. Some doctor, I think. One or two other people. No murderers.
Did Fleckstein act funny in any way?
What are all these questions?
I don't know. I guess once a journalist, forever doomed.
Give me a hand for a second.
Sure.
Could you hold these while I trim the roots?
Sure.
So, did Fleckstein act funny in any way?
No.
But you know what a complete lechery is.
Was. Did he try to get friendly with you?
He just said there was only one way to prove I was a natural blonde. I mean, what do you say to that?
Well, give me 2 weeks, I'll come up with a spontaneous answer. What did you say to him?
Nothing. Kind of went... But I told his nurse, Lorna Morrissey.
Yeah.
That her boss had one heck of a reputation. He was going to get himself in big trouble.
You said that the day of the murder?
Mm-hmm. She came in to tell him she was going home. And he stepped out for a couple of minutes, so we chatted.
Peg, she's going to tell the police that you said her boss is going to get himself in big trouble.
So what?
Peg?
Hey. Oh, Judith, that's idiotic.
Well, of course it's idiotic, but I know you. The police don't know you. They just know what she says to them.
Some nurse. Lorna wasn't exactly playing Florence Nightingale with Dr. Fleckstein.
You think she was having an affair with him?
I saw them.
No.
Well, I'm not doing it, Judith. But a couple of months ago, I was getting takeout at that Chinese restaurant next to the Royal Inn Motel. And who should I see coming out of the motel but Lorna Morrissey? And not 10 seconds later, right behind her, Dr. Fleckstein.
Did you tell this to the police?
No. I don't like to spread rumors. Can I help you?
Hi, I'm Lieutenant David Suarez, homicide.
This is about the Fleckstein case.
Right. When was the last time you saw Bruce Fleckstein?
Thursday. How's it going, the investigation?
Fine, thanks. Where did you see him?
Where? At his office.
Just in his office?
Well, he wasn't the kind to perform gum surgery at Pizza Hut. Look, I'm freezing. Do you want a cup of coffee?
Sure, thanks.
Oh, is black okay? I mean, I figured since you were a homicide lieutenant, you wouldn't want anything sissy like milk and sugar, sweet and northern.
This is fine, thanks. Okay, other than that, gum surgery, when was the last time you saw him?
3 weeks ago for x-rays.
And other than that?
Other than that, what?
I'm not here to embarrass you, but we're trying to find out as much about Dr. Fleckstein as we can.
Oh, that sounds right.
Why don't you tell me about the two of you?
Wait, you think that Fleckstein and I had some...
Well, you told Sergeant Williams...
I told him that he got a little overly friendly. That's all that I told him. God, I can't believe this.
You never were...
What?
Intimate with Dr. Fleckstein?
No, I could never be intimate with someone who wore a pinky ring, or any man for that fact, without a ring. I mean, other than my husband, who doesn't wear a ring, for your information. Do you understand what I'm saying? Right.
Here he is.
I am home.
Yay, Daddy's home.
Yeah.
Dumbhead, chicken duty, daddy.
Quiet. How are you?
Good.
Oh.
How was work?
Fine. How was school?
School was okay.
Okay?
What do you mean, just okay?
Daddy, what do you expect in third grade?
Hi, how was your day?
The usual. Joey flushed his submarine down the toilet. It was only $30, and I've been getting the honor of making small cupcakes for the newcomers' PTA luncheon, and Kate wants to know what a transsexual is. How was your day?
I am on the verge of a major coup with the SEC on Technotron. You know that idiot in Washington I was telling you about?
Harrison?
That son of a bitch, civil service nitpicker. I got him. I dug up a no-action letter that the SEC wrote 5 years ago. I can't wait to see that little bastard's face. Kaboom! Bleh, die, worm.
Do you remember who in your office was talking about Fleckstein?
Huh?
Who in your office was talking about Fleckstein?
Claymore Katz.
But Clay's a criminal lawyer, isn't he?
Yeah. You want to hear about it, don't you?
Yeah.
All right. Fleckstein was in big trouble.
How big?
Big. He was called before a grand jury and was about to be indicted.
For what?
Interstate transportation of pornographic material.
Pornography? My dentist?
Yeah, well, Clay said he was partners in a porn distributorship. Some of his business associates were real underworld types.
How could my dentist get mixed up with organized crime?
See, why are you still so interested in this murder? What did you tell her a transsexual was, anyway?
Oh, I told her to ask her father.
You have something to say.
Please keep your voice down. Do you have a free moment tomorrow? It's about the murder.
The murder?
Bring Nancy. This is important.
Mary Alice, did you know Fleckstein?
Yes. You might say I knew him. In the biblical sense?
Mary Alice Mahoney is a sub-anthropoidal horse's ass.
Who asked specifically to see you?
She just can't bear to play to an audience of one.
I can't believe she had the guts to have an affair.
I can't believe she stopped talking long enough to have one. Probably wasn't murder. Suicide. Fleckstein stabbed himself so he wouldn't have to listen to her.
Hi.
I can't thank both of you enough for coming.
You are only sisters. Look, more than sisters, you're friends. And you know what they say about friends. A friend in need is
a pain in the ass.
Let's start. Entree, boo. Well, I first met Bruce, Dr. Fleckstein, at a party. I knew instantly that there was something between us, something very powerful. Did you ever have that electricity with the man? I was wearing my black Halston. And anyway, he came over and he said hi, so
I'm leaving by 11, even if you're in the middle of your first soul kiss.
Well, to make a long story short, he called me the Monday after the party. He said I had enormous substance and let's have lunch. So I said to myself, well, it's just lunch. So I met him at the Mirren Palace.
Oh, next to the Royal Inn Hotel.
I know what you're thinking, but that was the furthest thing from my mind. Anyhow, he looked so handsome. Calvin Klein jeans, Armani silk shirt. Anyway, we ordered wine and then we looked at the menu and I decided...
Skip the lunch, skip the fortune cookies, get to the motel.
We met every Tuesday at the motel. Bruce said if we didn't have lunch, we'd have more time to, you know, be really close.
Mary Alice, you didn't say anything to us about this before. I mean, why are you telling us now?
He took some pictures.
Holy shit. What kind of pictures?
Pictures of me.
Nude?
Yes. And more.
More?
In all kinds of positions.
What kind of positions?
Tied up.
Tied up? It's S&M. You mean S&M?
Well, we'd just been doing it regular, but then he said that since our relationship was based on mutual trust, we should feel free to act out our fantasies.
Why the pictures?
He said these were sacred moments and he wanted to preserve them. He got this new Polaroid. He said he'd burn them after he looked at them a few times.
But why would he burn them if he was going to preserve your sacred moments?
God, I'm so scared. What if the police find him? What if they show him the key?
No, don't worry. We'll think of something.
Not fancy. You had that relationship with that policeman, you know, the one who answered your burglar alarm. Couldn't you call him and ask him to find out what the police have?
You mean Little Cupcake? Well, I haven't seen him in over a year.
He'd be glad to hear from you.
Okay, I'll call him.
No, Judith, Bob must have a partner who does criminal law. If you could just describe the situation to him without naming names and get his opinion. And you used to be a reporter. Could pretend you're writing an article on the murder and call up the police and try to find out what they have.
Mary Alice, what do you expect her to do? Say, hi, I'm Judith Singer, and did you happen to find a picture of a nude, tied-up lady in Fleckstein's files? You can look under M for Mary Alice Mahoney.
Oh, no.
It's okay, I'll think of something. I will think of something, it's all right.
Well, look who's here. Hi, sweet pea.
Hi,
girl. Oh, gorgeous. I'll be right in.
Okay.
Bye, Joey. Thanks for coming.
Nasty, that murder business.
Incredible.
Papers are having a field day. I know his sister-in-law, Brenda Dunk.
Are you going to the funeral tomorrow?
I don't know. I ought to. I worked with Brenda on the campaign to save the wetlands. I don't mean to sound naive, Judith, but do you know what they do at a Jewish funeral?
Do you want me to go with you?
I don't want to put you out.
No problem.
Oh. That must be Phyllis Fleckstein, the widow.
Not Mary.
The bald man with the funny hat is Dickie Dunk, Phyllis Fleckstein's brother. And that's his wife, Brenda. Let's go over.
Oh, thanks for coming.
Oh. Oh. Terribly sorry, Brenda. Dreadful shock.
It's dreadful.
A great guy. He's taken in his prime.
You know Judith Singer, don't you?
I'm terribly sorry.
Thank you so much.
You know, one minute you're the biggest gum surgeon on Long Island, and the next minute, goodbye, Charlie.
Phyllis. Kimberly. Nicole. Tiffany. family and friends. What can we say about Bruce Fleckstein? We can say what a tragedy this is, for Bruce was not simply a companion to his dear Phyllis. He was her beloved, her friend, her rock. What can we say to the many friends he loved so very, very deeply and who gave their full measure of devotion in return? And what can we say to his many, many grateful patients suddenly bereft? All we can say is that we must hold on to the legacy of Bruce Fleckstein, the memory of his warmth, his excellence, his thousand kindness.
Scott, are you okay?
I'm fine.
We have seen the press vilifying this man.
Were you and Bruce Fleckstein?
The only thing his grieving family has.
Did he take pictures of
him? Memory of his love, his decency, his reputation.
Not you too.
For Bruce was an upstanding
one of my friends.
I think enough's been said.
Executive Vice President of the Nassau County Periodontal Society, Men's B Singles winner for the last 2 years at Longmere Tennis Academy, Bruce Fleckstein, a man beloved, a man involved.
Hey, it's good to see you, Judith.
Thanks for taking the time.
I've been thinking about what you suggested on the phone. I even spoke to Ed about it, but there's no way we can use you on the Fleckstein thing.
Yeah, but you see, I know him, and I know the people,
Judith,
from his world.
We have three reporters on this. We just don't need a freelance.
But you know that I can write.
So can the three people I have on it. I'm sorry. So how long has it been since you've been here?
Seven years. Look, what if I came up with something really special?
Well, bring it in. We'll talk.
Okay, good. Thank you.
Nauseatingly prompt. It cannot be 1 o'clock. Why, Judith, how wonderful of you to stop by. You must meet a friend of mine. This is Jim Hogan. And this is Judith Singer. You will not believe this. One of Cupcake's, Jim's, best friends down at the precinct was the first one to see Fleckstein's body. You know, that dentist who was murdered.
Oh, yes. Are there any particular suspects?
You see, I mean, there's the mob and every lady that, yeah, you know.
Oh, right, there are enough people to populate Biloxi, Mississippi.
Any fingerprints?
What?
Fingerprints.
No.
Did you find anything in the office?
Yes.
What did you find?
Pictures of naked ladies. But doing stuff that you wouldn't be interested.
Where did you find the pictures?
Oh, they're stuck behind a drawer. You know, those skinny little drawers dentists keep their tools in?
Oh, Brucey should have kept his tool in a drawer.
I gotta go. It was nice meeting you.
Oh, same here.
Wednesday, right?
Right. Well, he certainly cleared my sinuses.
Well, I didn't get one piece of substantial information from him. I blew it. I didn't ask any of the right questions.
What are you going on about? You did fine. Come on, let's have a glass of wine.
Nancy, I'm so out of it. I went back to Newsday. It's been 7 years. It was like I never even worked before. They've got word processors.
Well, then forget it. Get your legs waxed. Take up bridge. Find a Fleckstein.
I want to get a job.
Well, toots, if you want to be a reporter, go out and get the story.
Hi. I'm Judith Singer. I'm doing a piece on Bruce Fleckstein.
A reporter?
I'm trying to get a psychological profile of Dr. Fleckstein. It'll be just between us. Be off the record, okay? We haven't even talked. How often did Fleckstein come here?
Tuesdays and Thursdays.
Every Tuesday and Thursday?
Not Thanksgiving.
Did he arrive with the same woman all the time?
Not really. They came and went.
Could you identify any of the women?
No, they waited in the car while he picked up the key. I don't know if I should be talking about this.
Oh, look, I really didn't want you to identify. That was the wrong word. I was trying to get an idea of the kind of woman that he preferred, you know, if he had any special type.
He had every kind.
Every kind. Every Tuesday and Thursday.
Like clockwork.
What are you doing here?
Nothing.
What are you after?
Nothing. It was morbid curiosity. I know I shouldn't have, but the door was just... It won't happen again.
Wait a minute. So what are you looking for?
Nothing. What, you don't think I was after the photographs?
What photographs? What photographs are you talking about?
How did you know about them?
Friend.
What kind of friend?
Journalist.
You want to tell me the name of your journalist friend? Give your friend the journalist a hot tip. You've just made the list of suspects in the Fleckstein case.
Bob? Sweetheart, can I talk to you for a minute?
Honey, can't wait. I've got a breakfast meeting with Joe Clark.
Well, it'll just take a second.
It's about the Fleckstein case.
Again, the guy was the worst. He got what he deserved. Forget about it.
You're absolutely right, but Bob, you won't believe what I just found out. Bob, he was having an affair with his nurse, and she's got a son in Joey's class. And also, I saw Scotty, and I've got this...
Let me make a deal with you. Just let me get through this week, and I promise, on Sunday, we'll do nothing but gossip about Fleckstein.
Bob, this isn't gossip. To me, it's human interest. See, what you don't understand...
Judith!
It's incredible.
Judith! What is the matter with you? I'm working on something here that could mean $500,000 fee to the firm. Don't make me into some sort of insensitive clod who tunes out his wife. I'm not. I have to do this. Okay. I promise on Sunday, 24 hours a day, total flex day.
Doesn't have to be 24 hours.
Yeah. How many? 18?
18 would be fine, thanks.
All right, let's lock our lips.
And throw away the key.
Yes.
Well, hi. I'm Brenda Dunk.
Oh, yes. How are you?
As well as can be expected. I've got a lot more to do.
Me too. I'll join you. I think it's terrible the way the press is treating this case.
It's dreadful.
The worst kind of yellow journalism. I feel terrible as a person. But as a journalist, I'm ashamed. I mean, it just shouldn't be happening.
You're a journalist?
Uh-huh. Well, I've been thinking of doing an article on the other victims, the survivors, you know, family tragedy, that kind of thing.
Uh-huh. Some of your relatives or Dr. Fleckstein's friends?
You could interview me. I'm not sure about my husband, Dickie. He's very upset about all the publicity.
Well, of course, but you might tell him that this is going to be a really, really sympathetic article.
Well, I'll talk to him.
Okay.
Well, you can just say that Dickie Dunk thinks the newspapers are full of 100% bull duty. I mean, it's bad enough that they won't let my sister Phyllis alone to be, you know, a normal widow. But they're calling us with all sorts of questions. You know, did we know Bruce's friends? Did he ever mention pornography? One slob old even calls here 11:30 at night.
No, that's terrible. I'm interested in... how you felt, how...
I felt terrible. Of course, we weren't actually very close. We saw them on holidays. We didn't socialize.
And you always said that Bruce was a little flashy. You know, pushy. Remember how you said that? Yeah.
Yes, I may have. But we weren't actually all that close.
Well, were you at odds with the Fleckstein?
No way.
I didn't mean to imply that.
No. Bruce even steered some business Dickie's way.
Yes, a little job, no big deal.
You're a dentist also.
Do I look like the kind of guy who likes to be up to his elbows and drool all day long? No, I have a printing plant. and I did some work for Bruce's Dental Association for school kids about gums. Well, why don't we have some coffee and cake?
Lovely. And what was your reaction to the charges that your brother-in-law was mixed up with pornographers?
Baloney. Look, I'm not saying he didn't have a few magazines on his night table. I mean, after all, he's a consenting adult. But pornography? Come on.
Yeah, that's very interesting. It's very valuable. So you think that the charge was just a fabrication?
Damn straight. Right, Angel Pie?
Bruce and I were not close, but he certainly wasn't the sort to get involved in any sleazy business.
Listen, just because Bruce had a couple of friends with Italian last names, now, that doesn't make them organized crime, does it?
No. My neighbor was Dr. Fleckstein's last patient, and the police have been terrible with her. Now, her last name happens to be Italian, but I...
Who is that?
I know. Peg Tuccio, right? I heard Phyllis telling someone that the police were asking her about Peg, about whether Peg and Bruce were friendly.
Huh. By the way, is her husband, you know, the godfather type?
No, he's a pediatric surgeon. But speaking of Phyllis, do you think that one of you could possibly ask her if I could talk to her?
I don't know.
It's very important. It's the kind of validation that an article like this needs. I mean, it's the kind of thoroughness that a magazine like The New Yorker insists upon.
The New Yorker?
Yeah. Oh, hi. I thought you were working late tonight.
No. Where were you?
Oh, no place special, Nancy. I was busy, so I just did a little shopping.
Where?
A&S. They're open till 9. Did you pay the babysitter?
Yeah, you owe me $6. Where were you?
I told you.
And where else did you go?
I don't have to give you an accounting of my every move. I mean, what do you think, I was out with another man?
Oh, don't be melodramatic.
And don't tell me I'm being melodramatic. You know, that for 10 years I have trusted you, and now...
You're acting crazy. Maybe you should see a psychiatrist.
Maybe you should see a psychiatrist. I mean, in all the years that we have been married, and you've been coming home in ungodly hours, I have never once asked you where you've been. And now tonight I am gone for 2 hours, and you accuse me not only of infidelity, of adultery, but of insanity. I mean, you have no right...
Finished? Can I go brush my teeth? You're finished. Fine. Every few months you have to have a crisis. I don't really love you. I don't think enough about our relationship. I don't really consider you my equal. Your big feminist crisis.
Don't patronize me.
Do you know what you're saying every time you create one of these scenes? You're saying, Bob, you're not doing enough. Bob, there's a hole in my life, and you can't fill it. I am always the villain. Let me tell you something. I work goddamn hard for you, and this marriage, and this family. And I could do with just a little understanding. I work 10, 12 hours a day solving everybody else's problems. The phone never stops ringing. The clients want to cry on my shoulders. The other lawyers in the office give up, dump it all on my desk. Well, Bob Singer can handle it. Sure. Fine, I'm the goddamn star of the corporate section, the goddamn 38-year-old wonder boy. I cannot do any more than I'm doing. And the only thing I ask when I get home is to have a home. And what do I get? I get somebody who always manages to remind me that whatever I do is not good enough.
Does everything always end up being about you? Did you get anything new from Cupcake?
How explicit do you want me to be?
Well, I got a lot from Cupcake. So far, our beloved Mary Alice has managed to keep her bony ass out of the sling.
they came up with three names from the pictures, and Mary Alice Mahoney is not on the list.
Good for her. Who is?
Well, the first is Nursie, and the second one was a member of Bruce's country club. Her husband is supposedly the king of preteen loungewear. The third was a junior leaguer with bleeding gums who broke down when the police paid a visit and told him all about the photo-taking sessions. Apparently, Miss Junior League was quite an earth mother. She liked having her picture taken in the kitchen, you know, with carrots and cucumbers sticking out. Oh, if ever I meet her, I must remember not to try her coleslaw.
What does this mean, lady?
I don't know. Maybe mind your own business, MYOB.
You know, like in high school?
Yeah, like in high school.
Who would want someone in this house to mind their own business? Who would?
The house is clean.
You obviously haven't seen my closet.
You think this is a big joke?
You call 911. Excuse me, miss?
Yes.
You know, you got a crack in your foundation. It's out by the azalea bushes.
Everybody shut up! Now. Lady, who wants who to mind their own business?
I don't know.
God. Well, why would anyone break in here and do this? Why?
The Fleckstein murder.
Yeah, well, what's that got to do with us? Who the hell did this? Did they get my cameras?
I've been doing a little investigative reporting and
What?
I asked a few people some questions and maybe what happened.
Are you crazy?
No, I am not crazy. Look, you get enthused over a hot securities registration. I get excited about an unsolved murder. It's a great story. I'm a journalist. And
you are a wife and a mother and a former journalist. So don't get grandiose with me. I want to know exactly what you've been doing.
I've been trying to tell you. You haven't been interested.
I'm interested now.
Oh, yeah, now you're interested because it's about you and your house. Where are you going?
I'm going to handle this. Judith, this is Lieutenant David Suarez.
What are you doing here?
Your husband called homicide. In trouble again?
Wait, you know each other? What the hell is going on here?
This is the lieutenant who's been questioning Peg Tuccio and everyone else in the neighborhood I told you about. I tried to tell you about it, Bob.
God damn it, I want some answers.
I would prefer not to discuss it right now.
Oh, you would. I've had it, Judith. I've had it with your evasions and your obsession with this thing. You want to get involved in a murder case? Do you? You want to deal with the police? Fine. Great. You go be a person in your own right. I'm going back to the office. I have to earn a living.
By the time I get a train back to the city, everybody in the office will be gone. I'll be there till 11 o'clock tonight. Thank you very much.
Okay, it's your turn. I'm sure you've got something to say.
What do you know about this?
Nothing. I was out all morning.
Were you out with your neighbor, Mrs. Tuccio?
So, I guess Fleckstein's nurse told you that Peg said Fleckstein was going to get himself in big trouble, and you think that means something. Well, let me tell you that the nurse was sleeping with Fleckstein, so she's not exactly a disinterested party.
What did you know about the nurse?
I listened.
Look, if you can help, I'd appreciate it.
Don't humor me, okay?
I'm too tired to humor you.
I'm sorry. Do you want a cup of coffee or a Coke or a piece of fruit or...
I'll take an apple, thanks.
Do you want to check this for prints or anything?
Jesus.
Thanks. Looks good.
Yeah, you get everything at a market on the corner. It's probably the same place where Fleckstein's fruit and vegetable queen got hers.
Damn it. Where did you see those pictures?
I didn't. I just heard about them.
Where?
I can't divulge my sources.
This is a homicide investigation. What the hell are you talking about? You can't divulge your sources.
I was a reporter for Newsday.
Was doesn't count.
Now I freelance.
Now you listen to me. I'm investigating a murder. And you know the one damn thing that keeps coming up again and again and again? You! Snooping in Fleckstein's office, messing around with photographs and with someone that... that's desperate enough to break into this house and do that. You think this is a game, Mrs. Sinder? I can have you arrested as a material witness.
How can you have me arrested? What have I witnessed? What are you going to tell the judge? Booker on a withheld theory charge, Your Honor?
You're not Evie!
Thank you.
I can't force you to cooperate. But you're making a mistake. You got a message. Whoever wrote it wasn't kidding. And whoever killed Fleckstein wasn't kidding either. I thought you were smarter than this.
Not a game. Kids didn't do this. I mean it, Judith. No more of this.
Your investigating days are over.
I know.
Don't you even ask who it is.
Who is it?
Police, idiot! I just stopped to save you some time. I thought when you saw the police cars parked outside, you'd spend at least a half hour investigating.
Why, I didn't see them. What's happening?
We found the murder weapon.
Where?
At Peg Tuccio's.
Oh, that's impossible.
We found it. It was stuck in the grating of a storm sewer in front of her house.
How did you happen to look there?
We, poked around a little.
Well, a little elf came to you in your dreams last night and told you if you poked around a little in Peg Tuccio's storm sewer, you might find something wonderful?
Jesus, you're a pisser.
What was it, an anonymous letter?
Phone call.
Man or woman?
Couldn't tell.
So what's your theory? You think that a psychopathic killer like Peg Tuccio wasn't content just to knock Fleckstein off? She wanted to play a little cat and mouse with the police, so she snuck the murder weapon out from under her unbleached flower, dumped it in the storm sewer, and then gave you a call so that you could be involved in it? Sorry.
It's all right. It's just that every time we get a new lead, it turns out to be a dud.
So you don't really suspect Peg?
I suspect everybody.
Yes, hello?
This is Phyllis Fleckstein. My brother Dickie told me you wanted to speak with me. About the article you're writing. About the way the media is treating my late husband. Hello?
Yes, I did want to speak with you, but I've taken on another project, and it's very long, and it involves a lot of research, and I don't think that actually now's the... But I do want very much to speak with you, so maybe I could see you tomorrow between like 9:30 and 10.
I'm at 6 Soundview Circle.
Okay, thank you. I'll see you tomorrow.
Goodbye.
Bye. Nice puppy. Nice dog. Nice puppy.
No, Prince.
Oh,
bad
nice dog.
Nice. Bad dog. No, Prince.
Ah, nice puppy.
Prince.
Nice dog.
Lie down, Prince. Lie down. Stop. Lie down.
I'm sorry. Listen, Bruce wouldn't get mixed up with pornography. He made a good living and had some fine investments. Are you sure I can't get you some coffee?
No, thank you. Then, how did this happen, Mrs. Flaxton?
Phyllis, please.
Phyllis, how did he end up in front of a federal grand jury?
Someone was out to destroy him.
Who?
I don't know.
Dickie? Your brother?
Dickie. What are you talking about?
Oh. Well, I just knew that your husband had sent some business Dickie's way, and then there had been a little tension between them, and then all of a sudden your husband was under investigation.
There was never any tension between them. Bruce did send business Dickie's way. He was a very generous man. And you know the worst thing? Bruce didn't know a thing about the pornography. He just heard some people saying they needed a printer. And just to be decent, he told them about Dickie. And the FBI is here with a search warrant.
How did you feel when you heard your husband linked with organized crime?
Look, he was a famous periodontist. He had been called in to consult on one of the Kennedys' in-laws' gum problems. How would a man like that know anything about organized crime?
By the way, how did he know that it was Dickie that informed against him?
Who told you that? I wake up in the morning and for a few seconds everything seems all right and... And then I realize what's happened. It's just this awful feeling. And every day is as bad as the next.
I'm sorry, really, I'm very sorry.
Ah!
That's what can happen if you don't ask who it is, understand?
I like your style. It's very subtle.
Thanks. I just dropped by. It's my day off. Any hot leads? Oh, no. Oh, come on. Oh, no. All right, tell me.
Look, I'll make you a deal. Come on in and I'll talk if you talk.
It's a deal.
Dickie Dunk gave the grand jury Fleckstein's name.
Where the hell are you getting your information?
Phyllis Fleckstein.
Phyllis Fleckstein?
I knew you'd say that. Okay, it's your turn. Why did Dickie talk?
He said he was repulsed by the books they were having in print. Stuff to appeal to the average white-collar child molester.
Well, what did that have to do with Fleckstein's Polaroids?
Nothing. The Polaroids were for Fleckstein's own use.
So the pornography Dickie was printing was something completely different?
Right. It was strictly a business deal.
So Dickie spilled the beans.
You've been reading too many mysteries.
I'm only trying to communicate with you on your level.
Thanks. Now stop being such a wise ass and tell me what else you got from Phyllis.
I'll go get my notes.
Does it make you nervous having me in your bedroom?
No. I can't handle this. Let's get some air.
Come on, I want to talk about us.
No, look, let's just talk about business, all right? Alibis.
All right.
Okay. Phyllis Fleckstein. Are you married?
Divorced.
Right, Phyllis's alibi. Where was she?
At the time of the murder, she was driving one kid to the library. Then she came home. The other two were there.
Okay. Do you have kids?
Two boys. The oldest is 14.
All right. What about the nurse?
The nurse, she was home making dinner, kids in the kitchen. Listen, the nurse, the wife, they all have alibis. Who cares? Come on, let's talk.
The Dunks.
He was in his printing shop. She was at the health club.
Is that a good alibi?
As good as any of them. Better than Peck Tucho, who manages to come up with a supermarket check with the time and date on it. Doesn't that sound a little funny?
No, not if you know Peck. The mob.
The mob, yeah.
What are you doing? Hey, come on, what is wrong with you?
Nothing's wrong. You're so sensitive.
You're so goddamn insensitive. Look, I said I can't, all right? Don't you understand?
Wait a minute.
I've got a family,
Wait a minute. Wait a minute. You think all I want from you is a quick hump? I'm no Bruce Fleckstein. I don't go around trying to score with every woman I meet. I don't care if you believe it or not. I don't give a damn.
Yes, you do.
Yes, I do.
Okay, yes. Yes, I do. I find him very attractive, but I am trying not to dwell on that, okay? Kate, no backward skating.
All right, Mom.
So what are you dwelling on? He's fun. He laughs at my jokes. And he listens to me. He makes me feel important. But I'm scared because I really look
forward to seeing him a lot.
Listen, Toots, you look like you're in control, as far as I can see. You're hardly acting like one of Fleckstein's crazy ladies. Lord, why did his women go for those messy liaisons? I mean, why couldn't they just kissy-kissy for a couple of hours, take a shower, and go home?
I don't know. I guess because they needed something else, don't you?
All I need is lots of good straight sex.
What about love and affection?
I get love from Larry. He does love me. And I love him.
So then, why other men?
Because they give me what Larry can't. Passion. Spontaneity. Novelty.
And you can't get that from Larry.
Can you get that from Bob?
Kate! Kate, I said don't do that!
Okay, Mom, okay.
Your friend Fleckstein's Polaroids. You sure you're ready for them?
It's not that I've never seen stuff, you know. It's just that these women could be friends. They've got kids. They squeeze cantaloupes in the market.
You expecting anybody?
No, it's probably just laundry or cleaner or the Jehovah's Witness or something like that.
Well, you certainly took your sweet time. What were you taking, a test flight on a new vibrator? Hey, congratulations. Mary Alice passed the lie detector test, and she's going to the DA with a lawyer. You fixed it. What is wrong with you? You are acting like a constipated chicken. Oh, I'm sorry. You didn't say you had company.
I'm David Suarez, Nassau County Homicide.
Oh, I'm Nancy Miller, Nassau County Big Mouth.
Judith. You knew about this Mary Alice and Fleckstein?
This is not your finest hour, Nancy.
No.
Well, yes. Look, Mary Alice spoke to me in confidence. And if she talked to the DA, that means that she didn't kill Fleckstein, so I didn't do anything to harm the investigation, so you really shouldn't be angry with me.
I should be grateful.
Well, let's not exaggerate, but...
I shouldn't punch you in the mouth.
No.
Well, I hate to eat and run. It's a very nice meeting you, and I'll see you later, Toots.
Okay, how angry are you?
No more dealing behind my back, understand?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now let's look at the pictures. We checked with a couple of sex shops. The props are very common. You can find them anywhere.
Yeah, sure. 2 for $0.99 at Grand Union. Oh, my God.
What is it?
David. David, this was taken in Fleckstein's house. I sat in that chair, and this is the Fleckstein's Nazi dog, Prince.
Can you identify the woman?
This is Brenda Dunk.
How can you tell? She's wearing a mask.
We belong to the same health club. I've seen her in the steam room. I mean, I recognize that terrific body and those 2 scars.
Okay, let's say it's Brenda.
It is Brenda.
That's got to mean something.
Yeah. But what?
But what?
90 years without slumbering. Tick-tock, tick-tock. It's less seconds numbering. Tick-tock, tick-tock. It stops short. Never to go again when the old man died. 90 years without slumbering. Tick-tock, tick-tock. It's less seconds numbering. Tick-tock, tick-tock. It stops short. Never to go again when the old man died.
Penny, for your thoughts.
Fleckstein case.
Joey, go tell your sister she was wonderful.
Dad.
Go tell your sister she was great.
Okay.
I thought this Fleckstein business was over.
What made you think that?
Because you hadn't talked about it for a few days. I assumed
we haven't had contact for the last couple of days. The only person I've been talking to has been your secretary, because you've been so wrapped up in your successful career, you really haven't... I have to make a phone call, excuse me.
Yes, Lieutenant Suarez, please.
Bob, excuse me, Bob, it's very important. I have to go to the station house. Mim Robinson said she'd take me, and I'll see you a little bit. Could you please, I promised Joey that he could sleep with his yellow truck. Thanks.
Visitor for you, Lieutenant.
Good evening, Mrs. Sarandon.
Good evening.
Thanks, Sergeant.
What did Fleckstein's women have in common? No special physical type, no particular personality trait, right? But they all were married to successful men. Every one of them had a dynamo for a husband except for one.
Brenda Dunk.
Right. Now, why would Fleckstein suddenly take up with the wife of a loser?
Maybe he was really hot for Brenda.
Still, he was very protective of Phyllis. I mean, why would he jeopardize his marriage by having an affair with his sister-in-law in his own house?
So he must have had a different reason for sleeping with Brenda.
He wanted something from Dickie.
Dickie? Wait a minute. To get Dickie to shut up, not to testify at the pornography trial. Dickie sees the pictures of his wife. Fleckstein has him up against the wall. He can't testify now.
Then if he can't testify, then Fleckstein's gonna walk and he's gonna be left doing time.
So Dickie finds a way out.
He kills him.
How are we gonna prove it? I want you to go see Brenda tomorrow morning. Get as much out of her as you can. Make sure we haven't underestimated her. We'll follow you over there. You'll be wired so we can hear what's going on. I don't want any surprises.
Oh, David, it is Dickie. I mean, who else is going to write MYOB? And what about Peg Tuccio? The minute that I mentioned that she was a suspect, abracadabra, the murder weapon shows up in her storm sewer. I mean, it's Dickie. I know it. I can feel it.
You're probably right, but I can't make an arrest on the grounds of feelings.
I better get you home.
Found out that the printing job that Dickie was doing for Bruce was pornography.
No. Really, it was gum care.
No, it was pornography for some of Bruce's mob friends, and when the FBI put pressure on Dickie, he informed against Bruce. Did Bruce say anything to you about his deal with Dickie?
Bruce said once when I ran into him on the street that Dickie didn't appreciate all that Bruce had done for him.
Did you have this conversation with Bruce before or after you began sleeping together?
Excuse me?
Brenda, I saw the pictures that Bruce took of you. Tell me about it. Brenda, Bruce had affairs with a lot of women. He took a lot of photographs. You're not alone. And when did it begin?
A couple of weeks before Bruce was killed. He invited me to lunch at the Mirren Palace.
Then you went to the Royal Inn Motel.
He'd done that with others too?
Yes.
Excuse me. Those pictures were symbols of our mutual trust. We weren't serious. Bruce said, let's use the dog. He didn't do anything. He was afraid of the flashbulb. The dog, not Bruce.
And what about the day of the murder? How did Dickie react?
Wait, you think Dickie had something to do with it?
No.
That's not possible. I can't talk about this anymore. Thank you.
Do you have a picture of Dickie? It might help eliminate him as a suspect.
Yes, I have several. Here's one of Dickie at his parents' 50th wedding anniversary luau.
Did good, didn't I?
I wouldn't have done it exactly that way.
Which is why you sent me in there.
It was a good move getting the picture.
Thanks.
I'll get copies made so we can show them to people who were in the building around the time of the murder.
Like Peg, Tucho.
No, all she saw was some doctor in the hall, and we've identified...
No. She didn't just see a doctor. She told me that she felt uncomfortable being with Fleckstein and that she was relieved to see that there was a couple of other people in the hall.
You're sure?
Of course I'm sure. I told you. She told me that there's another...
Let's go talk to her.
Me too.
Yeah, you too.
Okay.
So I'm not a suspect anymore?
No, they think whoever broke into my house is the murderer.
Recognize this man? Ever seen him before?
No.
I'd like you to think back to that night when you left Dr. Fleckstein's office. There were some people in the hall. Can you describe that for me?
One was a doctor, or a dentist. He had on a white coat.
You were uncomfortable being alone with Fleckstein. It was late. You wanted to go to the supermarket. You opened his office door. What did you see?
A woman at the end of the hall.
Go ahead.
Well, there's a man the other direction taking a drink from a water fountain.
Can you describe the woman?
Older. She's 60, 65. Boy, and this is real vague.
Oh, you're
doing
great.
Fine.
Well, thank you.
Now, The man standing at the water fountain, what did he look like?
I didn't see his face. He was bent over.
Is there anything distinctive about him? Anything that struck you?
Well, this could sound real strange.
Tell us.
Well, I remember looking at him and thinking about St. Paul. Now, why would I think that? Oh, well, I know why. Because there's a light reflecting off the top of his head, just like a halo. That's it. He's bald.
I'll get a search warrant for Dickie's printing plant. Mm-hmm. I want to get in there, take the place apart.
I'll meet you there.
No.
What?
There would be too many legal complications if you came along.
Come on, you're in charge.
That's why I have to make sure everything's done by the book.
Since when?
Look, if Dickie feels threatened, he could get dangerous.
Oh, you don't think I can handle Dickie Dunk?
You all right, you can handle Dickie Dunk.
People, and then now you won't let me there for when it's going to pay off?
The phone is ringing. The phone.
All right. I'll answer the phone, but stay there. I have something to say. Hello?
Judith. Hi, Dickie Dunk.
Oh, hi, Dickie. Yeah, how are you?
Peachy keen.
Listen, Hannah, I think I got some ideas for that article you're doing. Why don't you meet me...
parking lot behind the library, around 7. We can go for a drive.
Dickie, look, could we maybe have a cup of coffee instead of the Shorecrest Diner, maybe?
All right, around 7.
Later would be better. Maybe like 8 o'clock or even later, maybe 9:30. Something like that. Would that be okay?
Okay. All right.
Bye.
All right. We're going to do it my way. You'll come to the station house at 9 o'clock and we'll wire you. I'll have men posted around the restaurant.
You think he's trying to set me up?
Probably.
Now, you wait just a minute.
I don't need your permission to go. You know, if I want to go, I'll go.
Even though I might not be here when you get back? I mean that.
I hope you'll be here.
Yeah? You're ready to throw 10 years of marriage down the drain because of some crummy story.
Have I ever once called one of your cases crummy, even when it was? I mean, you have spent a year of your life on a stock registration for a company that makes non-dairy creamer, for God's sake. You know, for months you came home so late, you never saw the children. It was like this was a hotel and I was your maid.
What the hell are you talking about? I am a lawyer. That is what I do. Are you so goddamn bamboozled by this cop?
Look, don't bring him into this.
Shut up!
This is between
don't you have a mind anymore? Can't you think anymore, the goddamn bastard? He says jump and you jump?
It is not fair.
Shut up and listen to me. He says jump, and you say, how high, Lieutenant?
Look, I know what I am doing. Can't you give me some credit for having some sense of judgment?
Do you know what you're doing?
Yes.
Do you?
Yes.
Do you? Then do it, goddammit, and leave me the hell alone. Do it. Do it, goddamn you!
Dickie has the brains to have pulled this off now, do you? Drive. Drive.
Hi.
No, Prince! Idiot! You let the dog out!
Put the car in the garage.
Lock the door.
Right.
I want to know everything you know.
Can I get anybody anything? A tab?
What did you do with Dickie's picture?
Phyllis, you're not going to get away with it.
Cut the crap! Quiet, Prince! Get him something! Quick!
Okay.
Did you give Dickie's picture to the police? Did you?
Yes. They know all about Dickie. They're waiting for me right now. They're going to wire me before my meeting with Dickie. Look, Phyllis, it's just a matter of time before they find out the link between the two of you.
Here are the liver snaps.
Just give them to him, for Christ's sake. What do they know about Dickie?
Holy moly, Phyllis, go and batch.
Answer me!
He's crazy!
Just open the door. What do they know about Dickie?
Oh, God, he's barking and screaming. He's hysterical.
Just open the goddamn door and bleed him!
He's nuts out there. He's jumping around. Do I have to? Do I have to get bigger right now? He's your dog. Why don't you give him the damn liver snap?
God damn it, you can't do anything right!
He's crazy.
What the hell? You idiot! Go upstairs. I'll go this way. She's not there. She's downstairs.
Great.
Move it. Straight ahead. Sit over here. All right. Now talk. Talk!
Or what, you'll kill me? You're gonna do that anyway.
Phil, is that true?
Don't be an idiot. Please, I'll handle this. If she even breathes too hard, shoot.
Yes, officer.
Miss Fleckstein, we had a call from one of your neighbors. Your dog is creating a disturbance.
I'm sorry about that. He must have just gotten out when I opened the garage.
Miss Fleckstein, I just wanted to say, you know, personally, how sorry I am about your trouble.
Thank you.
My cousin, Paul Rooney, was a patient of Dr. Fleckstein. Dr. Fleckstein ever mentioned his name?
No, I don't think so.
Dickie, listen, I'm the only one that knows that you didn't kill Bruce. The police think you were the one.
Hmm.
Yes, they have a witness. Someone who saw you in the building around the time of the murder. You took a drink at the water fountain, remember, Dickie?
Well, Paul had this terrible pain in the bottom of his mouth, right down here. It was all swollen up and some pus, I think. Anyway, he was a stubborn guy, Paul, and he kept stalling and just swallowing aspirin. And finally, his wife, she's Italian, she said, listen.
I never should have shown Phyllis that Polaroid. When she saw Brenda with her dog Prince, she went crazy.
I didn't know what was going to happen. I mean, she just told me to wait outside by the water fountain and that she was going to go talk to him. And then she came out, and she was only gone a short time, and said, Bruce is gone. And in her purse were all these Polaroid photographs of women and this gun that she found.
So finally, Mr. Fleckstein, so he finally made an appointment, and sure enough, Dr. Fleckstein had to operate on him.
And you know what? There was hardly any pain after.
Oh, I'm so glad.
Dickie, if anything happens to me, you're going to go to prison for life. Do you know what that means? What will happen to Brenda?
Next time, no waiting for half your face to swell up like a balloon. Next time, you go straight to Dr. Fleckstein.
Thank you. He would have loved that. Thank because, you so much.
You know, when you meet a...
Good night, Mrs. Fleckstein.
Sit.
All right, give me the gun.
Stop.
What's the matter with you? Give me the gun.
Don't. Your fingerprints are on that. You know what that means.
Dickie.
Enough, Phyllis.
Dickie, let me handle this. Give me the gun.
I said enough.
Give it to me.
No.
Where's the phone? Is it in the kitchen?
Yes.
Okay, fine. We're going to call someone to help fill us up. That's good. Come on. Fine. It's okay. All right. Just go in the kitchen. We're going to call someone to help fill us up.
Just drop the gun.
Joe.
Cuff and bring the rights.
Joe, where have you been? Okay,
so I've been going crazy. I've looked everywhere.
But I was here.
I went to Nicky's office.
I was here with a homicidal maniac, a mad dog. A guy kept serving me dog yummies and Coca-Cola.
Please calm down. Everything's under control now. Thanks to you. Thank you. I don't have to tell you, you performed magnificently.
Oh, yes, you do.
You perform magnificently.
Thank you very much. No. Excuse me, I'm going to throw up.
Where the hell... My God, do you have any idea? The lieutenant. Suarez called. You were supposed to meet him at headquarters and you haven't showed up. Judith, he was asking me if I knew where you... Are you all right? What happened? Tell me.
I want to go write everything down so that I don't forget and
try to get the story in the morning.
Okay.
Got something nobody else has. It's good, isn't it?
Good? It's terrific. Too bad they couldn't use Brucey's Polaroid's illustrations.
Now, the best thing is that I'm already working on another assignment about that teacher that murdered her plumber.
Murder? Ooh, that means you will be talking to Lieutenant El Cutie Pio again.
Well, if it's his case, yes, I will be talking to him.
Judith, where are your values? He is Major Adorable. He is worth a dozen cuppy cakes. Come on. Not even once?
No, not even once. Nancy, okay. Bob can be a pain, but he's a good father, and he's trying to be a good husband.
I gotta go be an artiste. Congratulations.
Thank you. Oh, Nance, do you think there's a heaven for dentists?
Well, sure, but I think old Brucey went south for eternity.
Yeah, where he was tied hand and foot with dental floss and some creepy guy with bad breath is standing over him with grubby fingers in his mouth.
Having his teeth cleaned every hour on the hour.
And a root canal every other day.
Oh, I gotta go. Bye.
And no Novocaine and no gas.